Hello, my name is Michelle Ronia, and I will be ministering tonight on being a witness to all people for LifePoint Christian University and for Dr. Jean Herndon. This is Homiletics 101. So have you ever asked anybody a question, and when you were expecting just a simple answer, they started going on and on and on, and you're wondering where it's going? Well, Jesus did this with the disciples. In Matthew chapter 24, they were coming from the temple, and the disciples were commenting about how beautiful the temple was, and he said to them, all this is going to be destroyed. And so this prompted them their questions, and they said, tell us, when will these things be, and what will be the sign of your coming at the end of the age? That's Matthew 24, verse 3. And so Jesus was basically started talking to them, and he's telling them all these things that are going to happen before he becomes the Messiah. And because that's what they were asking, when are you going to be the Messiah? So he's telling them all these things that are going to happen. Oh, there's going to be wars and rumors of wars. There's going to be pestilence. There's going to be earthquakes in diverse places. But he's not really getting to the point, probably what they were thinking he was going to say. But he gave them this critical piece of information. And it's from verse 14. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all nations, and then the end will come. And now it may seem like Jesus was given a little bit of a rabbit trail here. He was going off course, but you know, Jesus never said anything that he didn't hear the Father say. And he never did anything that he didn't see the Father do. So he was doing exactly, he was saying exactly what God wanted him to say. He was telling them, these Jewish guys, that they had to go and preach the gospel that they had seen demonstrated for 3 years. They had to preach it to Gentiles. They had to preach it to other people besides themselves. They thought that the Messiah would set up his kingdom, get rid of the Roman oppressors, and come in, and they were going to rule and reign with him. It never entered their consciousness that he was going to do it a different way, that he had to come first as a suffering servant. And then he would be the conquering Messiah. It was way out there for the disciples. I know I often experience this, you know, when I think that I have everything figured out, and the Lord says, no, that's not my plan. That's not how I want you to do it. This is what I want you to do. This is who I want to use. And you think, what? And you know, when God wants to use you, sometimes you're thinking, do you want me to do what? Right? But it's God's plan, it's not our plan. And God's plan is always better than our plan, right? Yeah, I think so too. He's smarter than us. So the disciples, they had these barriers that we all can have with preaching to other people, to all nations, right? And so the key word in verse 14 is nations. And that word in the Greek means ethnos, or people group. And the Lucene 1982 committee, there was a meeting in Chicago, and it defined people group in this way. For evangelization purposes, people group is the largest group within which the gospel could spread as a church planting movement without encountering barriers of understanding or acceptance. And you can find that definition on the Joshua Project website. The Joshua Project is a really cool website. It talks about missions, it talks about people groups, which groups are unreached and which people groups are fully saturated. And so it gives you a lot of really cool information. One thing we want to think about is within each country, there are many different people groups. There's different ethnicities, ethnos, cultures, tribes, and people groups can even include castes. They can include age variations. They can include cultural differences. So, you know, like the millennials, that's a different people group than the senior citizens, right? Another example of this is the Phuthai people in Thailand. They live in Thailand, Laos, and Vietnam. And so they're one people group, but they're spread throughout several different places. And they're considered one people group because they have the same language, the same religion, and the same culture. So when ministering to the Phuthai people, you've got to realize that they're spread out, but they're one people group. And it's important to remember that our culture is going to influence how we think, right? How we do things. So we need to understand when we go to a different culture, we've got to learn about that culture. We've got to know what we're getting ourselves into. Don't just go into a culture and try to expect to change it. You know, they did that with the Native Americans and it didn't work very well. So we've got to understand that things, we want to learn what will prompt the people in that culture to respond to Christ. And it's going to be different in every culture. Now in our town, we have a military town and we have our own culture, you know, on the base. If you go and talk to a Marine or a sailor, they have their own way of thinking, their own way of speaking, their own jargon, euphemism, slang. And so if you're a civilian and you have no prior military experience, you may be really confused if you were to walk up into a conversation. I know Pastor John has had that issue before, and we've had to explain some things. So I came up with a little example. This is kind of humorous, but it's a little example of what you might hear if you were to go out to the base. So I'm going to do a little bit of role play here. Private Smokatelli, what's the POD tomorrow? At 06, we're going to meet at the grinder for all hands PT. Originally, it was going to be boots and utes, but there's a snafu and somebody didn't lock down the old course. Now it's green on green for UFR, which is going to be a cluster. After chow, we're having a junk on the bunk, and then meeting at the theater for a safety and OPSEC brief before the 96. What's your dope? Did you guys understand that?
No, I think
Oliver got it.
I didn't.
You guys probably didn't understand that. Let me give you the translation. Greetings, random generic name for a junior Marine that I'm using as an example. So every time we want to say, use an example for me, Marine, we say, Private Schmuckatelli. What are you doing tomorrow? And they say, at 6 a.m., we're meeting on the parade deck for company physical training. Originally, we were going to go in our boots and camis, minus the blouse, but there was a problem and someone didn't reserve the obstacle course for training. Now we're wearing a military-issued green t-shirt, green running shorts, and running shoes for a uniformation run, which will be chaotic. After lunch, we're having a uniform and equipment inspection on our beds in the barracks. Then we'll meet at the base theater, and they'll tell us not to drink and drive and to have safe sex. In addition, we'll have an operational security meeting before the upcoming four-day weekend. What's going on with you? So, and that's true. I kept a PG for you guys, but that's kind of one of the things that they would say, right? So like I said, Marines have our own culture, we have our own language, and we speak Marine. I can still speak a little bit of Marine. And for the disciples, speaking to the world would have been really weird and different. It would have been something that they wouldn't have been comfortable with. They would have had to get out of their comfort zone. And even Peter and Paul, Jesus had to give them visions and to show them that it was God's plan to go outside of the Jewish culture and to preach the gospel. It wasn't something they would have thought of on their own. As I put myself in the place of the disciples, I think of it in this way, and I think, what kind of stumbling blocks do I have with preaching the gospel to other people? And, you know, could it be fear of rejection? Apathy? Not feeling equipped? What if they ask me something I don't know? You know, these are all valid. I think a lot of us go through those things. But Jesus said this, you know, he was expressing his heart in his discourse to the disciples. And he said this, actually, Paul said this to Timothy in the Good News Translation, 1 Timothy 2, 5 through 6. For there is one God, and there is one who brings God and human beings together, the man, Christ Jesus, who gave himself to redeem the whole human race. That was the proof at the right time that God wants everyone to be saved. So we are his hands and his feet. The redemption of all mankind is God's heart, and it should be ours. So just in closing, do you guys remember the poster? We're looking for a few good men. Well, God's looking for a few good men and women to preach the gospel. So just keep in mind, when God wants you to preach and teach and talk to people, just ask for his wisdom and his words. Thank you.